Hello everyone, and welcome back down here to the Gamer's Den with me, your host, Jordan, your master of lore and storyteller extraordinaire. If you thought that I was just going to have a channel announcement here, although 100 subscribers is by no means a mean feat, it is an important one, that first big step towards building up to something greater. I still needed to have something else here. There wasn't going to be a snowball's chance in hell that I just let today be an announcement. And so, to that end, since I have everything ready anyways, we are going to be continuing on with the Loremasters Spell Guide, and we're touching on a spell that has just become so ubiquitous and iconic to the fantasy genre that it's spread to so many other things aside from just tabletop games. I'm, of course, talking about the legendary fireball spell, if you didn't surmise that already from the movie or video title. Now, for the fireball spell, this has been in numerous games since the 1970s. Rules for Middle-earth, Chainmail, and the original Dungeons & Dragons. It's, like I mentioned before, so iconic and ubiquitous that it's in nearly everything fantasy. It's in so many things sci-fi as well. It's stayed the same, essentially, since first edition Advanced Dungeons & Dragons, and it deals a max of 10d6 points of fire damage in a 20-foot radius, potentially burning and destroying many items, all the way up through until Pathfinder. There are some notable exceptions, however, including 4th edition, where it was a 3d6 plus intelligence modifier daily attack spell. As if we didn't need another reason to dislike 4th edition. And then, of course, 5th edition Dungeons & Dragons, where it deals a significant increase in damage when you get it. However, it has always been a 3rd level spell for wizards and sorcerers, regardless of the edition that you find it in. And specifically, its statistics, its casting time, it takes one standard action. It's a long range going out to 400 feet plus 40 feet per level. So by the time you get it at 3rd level, you're looking at 480, 520 feet total. Area of effect is that 20-foot radius. It's an instantaneous effect. Reflex saves for half, and it allows for spell resistance. And this spell is an explosion of fire, dealing 1d6 points of fire damage per caster level, up to a maximum of 10d6 to every creature in the area of effect. You point your finger at the area that you wish to strike, with a small pinpoint of fire conjuring at your fingertip. If you attempt to fire through a narrow point, such as an arrow slit, a gap in a doorway, etc., you must make a ranged touch attack, or the fireball strikes the outside of the barrier, and then it detonates. And it'll deal damage to the barrier if it's capable of doing so, and possibly some of the fire might filter through, but you won't hit the area you intended. The spell will set fire to combustible objects and metals like gold and silver. Now, this is what you find in 3rd edition and Pathfinder, and of course all the previous editions of Dungeons & Dragons. You even see this to some degree crop up in other game systems, but we're going to mainly focus on this here because many of the things I've harped about, this spell is classic. It is iconic. And like I said before, no wizard or sorcerer would be caught without it in most instances. It's a common, ubiquitous spell, and it's really, really useful for clearing out a lot of low-level monsters. Swarms of goblins, fireball. You have a bunch of ghouls down in a crypt feasting on some fresh bodies or even some old, decaying, rotting corpses. Fireball. Fire's perfect for cleansing them and rooting them out. But there's a couple of things here. First off, reflex save for half. Now, if you're a level 10 wizard or sorcerer, that's 10d6 points of damage. That's a maximum possible of 60 points. It's not bad at all on the surface of it, but that reflex save for half presents some problems, because that reduces that 60 down to 30, and at level 10, maybe not every creature you face can readily eat 30 points of damage, but a lot can. And at level 10, you're really starting to see monsters with a lot of fire resistance. Maybe it's 5 points, 10. It's not uncommon to see 15, and certainly you might occasionally run into 20. And so that 60 points, assuming that you're at 15, is down to 45. But that doesn't kick in till the reflex save happens. So 60 down to 30, then minus 15, and it's only taking 15 points of damage. And of course, this assumes that you're not running into something that's just already immune to fire damage, which is the most common immunity in 3rd, Pathfinder 3.5, 2nd edition even had fire resistances. It's just, there's so many things that just reduce that damage down. And this doesn't even cover things like uncanny dodge, which will automatically reduce damage by half, even on a failed save, and on a successful one, nullifies it to zero unless the character is somehow denied their dexterity bonus, which negates their ability to make a reflex save. So it is a very useful spell, and it can deal a lot of damage in the right situation, but it's also really easy for it to be nullified, for it to not have enough of the desired effect. And it requires an investment of certain feats. Like in 3rd edition, the most common way to get around this was to build up into the energy substitution or energy admixture feats, which allowed you to substitute damage types. So you could go from a fireball to an ice ball or a thunderball, or friends and I always called it the sonic boom for dealing sonic damage. So that would lend the spell quite a bit more diversity, but that required extra investment on the player's part. And particularly for wizards and sorcerers, feats were not a common thing for you to get. So if that was something you were going to do, you had to do it at the outset. And typically it would come at a cost for other things. And really, you would get more mileage out of something like, say, augment summoning to boost the statistics of monsters and creatures that you summoned, which would just do so much more for you on a mechanical level that it would be silly to do otherwise. Just settle on building this one particular iconic, although flawed, blasting spell into something more useful. Especially when you had other better options to work with, like haste. Haste will do so much more damage than a fireball will. But that's a whole nother thing there. Things changed up a little bit when 5th edition came around. For 5th edition, the spell's statistics changed a bit. It still took one action to cast. Its range was significantly reduced down to 150 feet, but it still affected that 20-foot radius, and its area of effect was at 20-foot radius, and it's was still an instantaneous duration. And the flavor text switched a little bit too. A bright streak flashes from your pointing finger to a point you choose within range that then blossoms into a low roar into an explosion of flame. Each creature in a 20-foot radius sphere centered on that point must make a dexterity saving throw. A target takes 8d6 points of fire damage on a failed save, or half as much damage on a successful one. The fire spreads around corners. It ignites flammable objects in the area that aren't being worn or carried. At higher levels, when you cast the spell using a spell slot of 4th level or higher, the damage increases by 1d6 for each slot level above 3rd. And another thing to note is that if a target is wearing full plate armor, they take penalties against their dexterity saves, making the spell much more useful against a wider variety of targets. Now, fire resistance and fire immunity still crops up, but not with quite the same severity or frequency. That, and the fact that this deals such a significant amount of damage right off the bat, a 3rd level spell, being, you know, around that time you're about a 5th level character. Well, I mean, breaking this out, the types of opponents that you're using this against, that's going to be really useful. That is a huge amount of damage to be getting right off the bat there, and affecting things in an area. That's just incredible to have. And the fact that not all of the resistances are quite as bad or as common is helpful as well. You still run into it, and you will still have problems, but the viability and usefulness of this spell has definitely been altered significantly. It's much more useful now. It's a much more effective spell with the changes to the overall rules and the mechanics. So, fifth edition, and assuming through sixth and seventh, however many editions Dungeons and Dragons gets carried forward, Fireball will be much more useful if it follows this same or similar rule set. So, all of my bitching and complaining from before about the Fireball spell, that applies towards, Pathfinder, previous editions of Dungeons and Dragons, but just depends on the system you're playing is what it boils down to. But this has been a look at Fireball. This Fireball is, of course, cropped up in so many other settings with so many other different rule sets that we could probably talk for a much longer time if we allowed for that. But I've got to try to rein it in a little bit. And if you've enjoyed today's content, this particular video, why not wander on down there and click the like button, or even leave your comments and thoughts down below. I'd love to read over them. If you have some other ideas, other spells that you really like that, despite their flaws, just really strike that special something for you, well then go down and talk about that too. More than happy to engage in the exchange of ideas and information. And certainly the activity doesn't hurt my channel either. But if you've been enjoying content overall here, well, there are going to be a couple of other videos here cropping up that you might enjoy as well. And if you've been liking things overall, well then hell, consider subscribing down below. We'd greatly appreciate it for you to be here at the Gamers Den. Regular members are always welcome. And new members as well. But with that said, I've been your host, Jordan, your master of lore and storyteller extraordinaire. Thank you all so much for your time, and have yourselves a good night.